Won't you all together wander for to me? Come on, lift your voice. Here I am to worship. To say that you ought to lift your hands in the sanctuary. out. In moments like this, you can either look in or you can get in. I'm inviting somebody in the sanctuary to jump in with me. Jesus! Blessed Savior! Come on, slip your hands up in the air if you know he's a blessed Savior. Jesus! Blessed Savior! Jesus! Blessed Savior! He's worthy to.
Understand what I'm talking about.
understand what I'm talking about. Only people who see you restore your family understand what I'm talking about. And those are the people that don't mind saying, I give you praise. I know there are places that don't believe in the power of the blood anymore, but I still believe in the blood. Elder Lindsay, I still believe in the blood. The blood still works. You want to look at somebody and say, the blood still works. Testimony about the superintendent's brother, it reminds me that the blood still works. When I look on the second row right there to my left and your right, I'm reminded that the blood still works. Because Bishop Wright should have been dead and gone, but by the hand of God, he's still here. The blood. Trying to behave tonight, but I feel
God
stretching out in me tonight. I feel something supernatural about to happen in here. Hallelujah. Woo! Good God, good God. If y'all really understood what was going on in this sanctuary right now, you don't have to walk out of here with any kind of sickness in your body. You don't have to walk out of here with any sickness in your body right now. And you don't have to wait on me to lay hands on you. The Bible has given you proof that healing is the children's bread. It belongs to you. You ought to reach out and take it right now and declare, I'm healed. Yes, I am. I'm healed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Being in this house, get your Bibles in your hand. We're going to the Word of the Lord. Because if I don't get out of that right now, I won't come out of it.
Will you get that
silver? If I don't get out of it now, I won't come out. Because God has been so good to me. Now, everybody doesn't recognize it, and that's fine. But He's been good to me. I
me too.
I have about 3 or 4 witnesses.
Me too. Yeah. Yes, Lord. Me too. Yeah. Me too.
He's been good. Yeah. And the thing is, I don't just shout over what He's done.
Yeah.
Can't get no help there.
Come on. Come on.
I don't just shout because I got a check in the mail.
Yeah.
I don't just shout because everything might be going well at a particular moment in time.
Yeah.
Because there will come a day when life will happen and things might not be going so well. And if you are contingent upon the stuff that He does for you to thank Him, then you're going to be in a bad state of mind when something happens that might not seem so good. Oh, I wish I had a church. But when you understand who He is, when your praise is based on who He is, it changes your mindset.
Yes,
sir. So I'll shout no matter whether I got a check. Let me put it like Paul said. I've learned how to be a base.
Yes, sir.
And I've learned how to bow. But whatever state I'm in, I've learned how to be content. How can you be content? Because the joy of the Lord. Okay, I'm gonna quit.
Help yourself.
Ooh, God, I feel like
help yourself.
Here.
Hey, help yourself.
Somebody just holler, he's my everything.
Yeah.
He's
my everything.
Yeah. He's my everything.
He's my everything.
Yes, he is. We're going to the book of Exodus. I wrestled today with what I was going to preach tonight. Some of the preachers understand my dilemma. Because to be honest with you, I still got some more meat on the bones from last night.
Yes, Jesus. Lord, you do. Yes, you do. Yes, you do.
There's still some meat left on those bones from last night's message.
Mama, mama.
Lord,
mama.
Heal me.
Yes,
for real.
Yeah.
And I struggle because I have that in my heart. Trying to get that out. I'm trying to release that from my heart. Then on the other hand, I've been dealing with something in my heart. And I've actually preached it in a couple of different places, but I can't let it go. I want the oil.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
So preachers, y'all can see my dilemma, can't you?
Put it together.
Yeah.
Come on.
So tonight, I feel like the Lord has directed me to go ahead and preach on the subject, I want the oil. I want the oil. Is there anybody in here who can say, God, I really want the oil? We're going to the book of Exodus, chapter number 30. Exodus chapter number 30. Exodus 30. If you have it, would you say amen?
Amen.
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 Glory to God. And I'm going to, before I go to Exodus 30, I'm going to read just briefly Matthew 26 as a background text, verse number 7.
All right.
And then I'll come to Exodus 30. It says, there came unto him a woman having an alabaster box of very precious ointment, and poured it on his head as he sat at meat. But when his disciples saw it, they had indignation, saying, to what purpose is this waste? For this ointment might have been sold for so much and given to the poor. Jesus understood it. He said unto them, why trouble ye the woman? For she's done a good work upon me. The poor you have with you always, but you may not have, but me you have not always. For in that she hath poured this ointment on my body, she did it for my burial. Verily I say unto you, wheresoever this gospel shall be preached in the whole world, there shall also this, that this woman hath done, be told for a memorial of her. Mm-hmm. Then we go to Exodus chapter 30, around verse 22. Hallelujah. If you have it, say amen.
Amen. Amen.
Moreover, the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, take thou also unto thee principal spices of pure myrrh, 500 shekels, and of sweet cinnamon half so much, even 250 shekels, and of sweet calamus 250 shekels, and of cassia 500 shekels, after the shekel of the sanctuary, and of oil, olive, and hin. And thou shalt make it in holy thou shalt make it an oil of holy ointment, an ointment compound after the art of the apothecary. It shall be a holy anointing oil. Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask that you would anoint me afresh to deliver this your word today. I pray tonight, God, that you would release your power, your might, and your healing in this place in the name of Jesus. And for this we give you glory, we give you praise, we give you honor. Let the hearts of the people be receptive, not just in this room, but there are people who are watching live on social media. We pray for them right now. We pray, oh God, that you administer to their lives through this word tonight in Jesus' name. And everyone said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. You can be seated in the presence of the Lord. I do honor the Lord tonight for the pastor of this church, Pastor Jefferson. Can Amen. You all thank God for the man of God? Amen. But that is kind of thing, I need y'all to help me honor this great man of God.
Amen.
Amen.
And as you're honoring, I would ask that you also help me to honor my bishop, Bishop Gary E. Wright.
Amen. Amen.
One of the greatest men of God I know.
Yeah.
He's one of the unsung ones.
Yes, he is.
One of the men that God has raised up to be a father in the gospel and a father in the kingdom. And I thank God for him. I thank God for my First Lady Frenchie Wright.
Yeah.
And in case y'all didn't know, she's a preacher in her own right.
Yes, she is. Yes, she is.
Oh, Lord Jesus, she will preach the fool out of a place.
Yes.
I've seen her do it.
Yes.
And I thank God for her. I thank God for all the other ministers of the gospel. I want to thank God also for, thank God for Elder Lindsay.
Yes.
My little drummer right there, Brother Rolando. I appreciate him. And one of the best churches this side of heaven. I thank God for them. Now, all 5,000 of us couldn't get here tonight. So
watch out now.
All 5,000 couldn't come tonight, so we just brought a few to represent. So I thank God for Kingdom Life Church of Knoxville. Now, just because I called those other names doesn't mean that those of you that are sitting in the sanctuary are not important.
That's right.
So I thank God for all of you being here today. Give yourselves a hand. Tonight, I understand, and I'm in a very different place than I've ever been in my life, even as a preacher. God has been shifting me. And it's a very unique place to be because it really means you have to walk alone. Because when you start walking in certain places, people don't understand where you can try and explain it all you want to, but people don't understand that place. And so you have to sometimes walk alone, and God will begin to deal with you and speak to your heart about things. And I can honestly say that in my time with God, my heart has become troubled and concerned for the body of Christ. Why am I so concerned? Why do I feel this burden for the body of Christ? Because the body of Christ is in a stupor right now. Yeah, this is one of those messages that need to go across Facebook. It needs to go across social media. We're in a stupor. We're in a position where we've been hit with so much, and so much has gone on that people are literally walking around functioning in their dysfunction.
Yes. Mama, yes. Mama, mama,
preach.
We're mounting pulpits, but we're dysfunctional.
Yes.
We've got great bands, great praise teams. We sing well. We know how to play the right music. We know how to do the right bump. We know how to hype the people. But we're dysfunctional.
Yes, yes.
It is possible to function in your dysfunction.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir. Yes.
Some of us know that firsthand because we do it day to day in our lives.
Mm-hmm.
We're living broken. But we get up in the morning and we still fix the coffee. We still fix breakfast, call everybody down to eat breakfast. If you've got somebody in your family, in the household with you, you call them down to eat breakfast. You do the things you normally do.
Okay.
You get up, you go to work. Work 8 hours a day, 10 hours a day, 12 hours a day. But still, dysfunctional. What we have been taught to do, I mentioned it last night, we've been taught to fake it until we make it.
Yes, sir.
We've been taught to try and just make things look good.
Yes.
Yeah.
And so we function in our dysfunction. It's almost like we become robots. We know that I've got things I have to do, so I'm just going to go ahead and do them. And the sad thing is, and this is what the Holy Ghost began to deal with me about today. One of the things, he said, what has happened is we have been conditioned. And this is what I was talking about last night when I said I want to be healed for real. Because when we've been religious and in the religious environment and in the feel-good environment,
come on.
We have been taught, hurry up and get past whatever's going on in your life.
Come on.
So we have conditioned ourselves. Conditioned ourselves to push it up under the rug and keep it moving. And we tell ourselves that we have dealt with it and we're good.
Wow.
I ain't got to talk about church.
Come on.
But we tell ourselves that the things that we have gone through, maybe you've gone through a divorce, maybe you've lost a job, maybe your family is in turmoil right now, whatever might be going on in your life, we push it under a rug. We act like it didn't happen.
Yes.
Amen.
We've been conditioned to just push it down and forget about it. And when somebody asks you, how are you? I'm good.
Say it. Oh, say it.
Yeah, thank you, Elder. We got our Christianese language that we speak.
Yeah. Come on, Elder Long.
How are you?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm too blessed to be stressed.
Blessed and highly favored.
Blessed and highly favored.
Yeah. Say something.
Thank you for your faith confession.
Uh-huh.
But you know underneath the surface you're still not healed for real.
Yeah, real.
Just as a point of recap from last night, so what we do is we go to church and we live for the feel-good message. We live for that message that makes us feel better. That masks our pain.
Yeah.
But one thing I have come to discover is that healing is a process.
Yes. Process.
Sometimes in the healing process, you're going to have to deal with the hurt.
Yes.
You're not going to be able to just push it under the rug anymore.
Right.
I'm going to talk about men for a moment. What we tend to do, we'll get a pain in our body, especially men. Now, women tend to get up, they'll go to the doctor, but men, we don't tend to like to go to doctors.
That's right.
It takes until the pain becomes excruciating before we make our way to a doctor to see about getting some help.
Watch out.
Because we say, I can take it. But by the time we get to the place where we realize we need help because it's hurting so bad, by this point, sometimes we're past the point of no return.
Amen.
Or they gotta give us more medication, more stuff. They gotta keep giving us the heavier stuff that we might not have had to have had we gone in the initial phases. We waited so long.
That's right.
So, we're not healed for real. We put it off. We act like I'm good. But the problem is in the body of Christ, again, we are functioning, but we are dysfunctional. We're going to church, getting our feel-good message to mask the pain. But when it's all said and done, we're still not healed for real. Preachers are giving us band-aids for a broken arm.
Watch out. Yeah.
Since when, Elder, have you ever seen a band-aid help a broken arm? Since when, Micah, have you seen a band-aid heal a broken heart? Granny, you were in the nursing field. Maybe you can help me out. Have you ever seen a band-aid heal a broken heart?
Come on, come on.
But in church, we've been giving people band-aids.
Yeah.
That's what Jeremiah chapter 8 said. Why are you recapping, overseer? Because I come to understand that what God really wants is a powerful church.
Yeah.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes, he does.
Yes.
What he wants is a sober, oh Jesus. What he wants is a sober church.
Yes.
Okay, I'm going to give you a Bible in the back there. He says things like, be sober.
Yes.
Be vigilant. That means keep your, he says, you can't be drunken by stuff. You gotta be watching. You gotta have a watchful eye. Be sober and be vigilant. I'm gonna tell you something, and I need you to hear this. This is a very important point of my message tonight. One of the ways that the enemy keeps us on lockdown is if he can keep us focused on and nursing our pain.
Yes.
Amen. So all I've got to do is keep hitting you in the same area where you've always been hit, where I know I've always done damage to you. Keep reminding you of your past. Keep reminding you of the stuff that is going on in your life.
Yes.
If I keep hitting you in the same place, I will always keep you nursing your wounds. Let me show you the picture. If I'm nursing my wounds, nursing what I've been through, nursing what I'm walking through right now, I'm looking down at the wound and I'm not watching what's going on around me. And that's why the enemy has crept into the body of Christ unaware. We've been so busy licking our wounds that now the enemy has come in. Wait a minute. He's come in and he's crept in among our ranks. All the priests tonight. And he's killing us from the inside, not from the outside. Because we have not been watching. We have not been sober. We have not been vigilant. We have been busy licking our wounds. He's caused one group of enemies to hit us, so we keep licking our wounds so he can sneak in and take, watch this. Oh God, help me. He's hit. What he does is when he infiltrates our ranks, he's not coming just after you. He's coming after the generation to follow. And he sneaks in among our ranks. Lord, I feel like preaching in the air. When he sneaks in among our ranks, what he is doing, he's coming after the younger generation. Kill the cub. Kill the cub. I like watching Nature Channel.
That's right. Come on. Say it.
When I watch the Nature Channel, Bishop. The lions.
Come on.
When one lion is trying to come in and take over the pride, he'll fight the other lion. And then when it looks like he's getting victory, what he does is every one of that lion's cubs, he kills them all.
He does.
So he can start his own generational seed among the pride. And what the devil has done, he has come in among the ranks of the body of Christ, and he has killed the genuine sons and daughters in the kingdom. here's the scary thing. What it looks like. You got new cubs that are born. They look like the old cubs. But they got a different gene going through them. They look like the old cubs, but they got different DNA flowing through them. That's what's going on in the church right now. We got folk that look like the lion, but look like the old cub, but they're not the old cub. They got different DNA in them.
It's right over.
Yeah.
Standards have gone down.
Lord, Lord. Yes, they have. Yes, they have.
Some of y'all think I'm just talking about homosexuality. No, I'm not just talking about homosexuality. See, that's the problem. We stick with that one. We don't deal with the rest of them.
Come on,
my Bible says a little leaven.
A little.
Didn't say what kind. It says a little leaven.
Yeah.
Will spoil the whole lump.
Yes.
So whether you a liar, an adulterer, a fornicator, unforgiveness, you still got something in you that's pouring DNA.
Yes.
Yes. But the standard has gone down.
Yes.
We don't want God for real anymore.
No.
God is trying to raise up a powerful church.
Yes.
But we're busy. So we don't see the enemy creeping in. We're not watching. We're not in warfare. If I can keep you licking your wounds, you won't spend time in prayer. Can I take my time and work tonight, please? I need this to get out tonight. I gotta get this out of my belly. You'll spend time so worried about your wounds, you never mature and grow up in God. You will find yourself, every time you get down on your knees to pray, you will find yourself praying about us more and no more. You'll be so busy licking your wounds. You won't be concerned about the body of Christ at large. You won't weep for kingdom principles when we get out. Now when we get up behind the platform, We say things like, I'm blessed beyond measure. I'm a giver. I'm a seed sower. So I know God always supplies my need. But then when hell breaks loose in your life, you don't confess God's going to supply. I'm coming on up the hill.
My mind. It's right in here.
So, enemy getting us, keeping us preoccupied, keeping us sick physically, mentally, emotionally. Financially, keeping our home sick, keeping our marriages sick, keeping our children sick. We got anger problems, unforgiveness problems, depression problems. Sick. And because we've been there for so long, we're comfortable with where we are. We say, I want out. It's like the man who says, I want to lose weight, but never goes to the gym.
Right.
Let me take a drink right there.
That's right.
Because I know I just upset somebody. It's like a man who says, I want to lose weight, but no changes his diet.
That's right.
Oh, preach long. Not just says, I want to lose weight, but the man who says, I want to be healthier, but never changes his diet. I need to say it like that because what I need you to understand is many of us in the body of Christ, we say, I want to be healthier, but we don't change our diet. We don't change the way we eat in the spirit. We're still eating on the stuff, the scriptures that we like, the scriptures that feel good. But we don't eat the stuff that's good for us, that will change us, that will transform us. We don't go to the Bible for those. We don't go to spiritual laxatives that say purify yourself from all filthiness of the flesh, perfecting holiness. Because it means I got to look at myself. And I'd rather believe my own press report. Well, holler back at me now. I'd rather believe my own press report. I'd rather believe that I'm somebody wonderful. I'd rather believe that I'm somebody great. I'm a good person. Well, good people go to hell too. You brought me here for the Azusa conference, right? Well, if there's going to be an outpour and an outbreak, we got to get some of this stuff together so our hearts will be right to receive what God wants to pour out when he's ready to pour out a fresh wind in the church. We don't run personally to scriptures like created me. Renew a right spirit. See, we do it because that song is poetic. But we don't do it because we mean it for real. I got to hurry. So we don't mean it for real, because if we did, we'd be evaluating ourselves daily. We don't want to evaluate ourselves. We don't want to check ourselves.
I know you're right. Come on, dude.
No, it feels too easy, too good.
I know you're right.
Just keep going like we've been going. Last I checked, they tell me definition of insanity is keep doing the same thing over and over again and expecting the results to change. You say, well, look at what I've done so far. What I did so far got me here, but what you did so far was it got you here, but that's what's going to keep you here. If you're going to go to another level, it's going to require you to press beyond what you've done before.
Come on.
Well, see, it gets quiet when you start talking like this. But see, the problem is we don't want to spend more time in prayer. We don't want to spend more time in worship. When most of us get, okay, I got to hurry, I got to get off of this. Most of us get most of our worship on Sunday morning and Wednesday night.
Mama.
If you even come on Wednesday night. Okay, let me move because I'm going to get in trouble. So now, so God wants to bring us to the place where he has a powerful church. And if he wants to bring a powerful church, we've got to get past the place, according to 6:1, Hebrews 6:1, we've got to get past the place where we're living in the elementary things of the gospel. Some of us say, well, I don't understand that, so I ain't going to worry about reading. No, you need to know the whole book. Get the whole counsel. Oh, come on, talk to me, Zion. Get the whole counsel of the book. Don't just get the stuff you like. Okay. He wants a powerful church. So I said tonight, I'm preaching from the subject, I want the oil. Oil in the scriptures is a symbol and a sign of the anointing. Bible says, and the yoke shall be destroyed. The thing that the enemy has used to hold you and to keep you going a particular way that you've always gone is going to be destroyed because of the
oil.
Anointing. Because of the oil.
That's right.
Why do you talk about being healed? Because before you can ever effectively carry the oil on your life and in your life, we need to be healed.
Yes.
So we won't be broken carriers.
Come on.
Of the oil.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
I come to tell you that many times, Elder, you got my back right here. Many times what's happening is we are filtering the things that we say and do. We are filtering the oil through our broken places in our lives. The tainted and the jacked up places, we are filtering the oil. We're filtering it through those places. We're filtering it through that. So what comes out that we call the oil is really our issues. We only know how to preach our issues. Because we're filtering it. Our brokenness. The oil is coming through our brokenness. And I'm not talking about the God brokenness. I'm talking about the brokenness of the enemy that we've not allowed ourselves to be healed from. Let me move. And so we gotta get to the place where we say, God, I want you to heal me so I can be a carrier of the oil. I want to be a carrier of the oil. I want to be a vessel that is available to you that you can use any time that you want to. I want to be a vessel that you can use in any way that you want to. I want to be a vessel unto honor and not unto dishonor. So Lord, take me down to Jeremiah 18. Take me to the potter's house and make me over again. Somebody holler, Lord, make me over again.
Lord, make me over.
The Bible says in Jeremiah the 18th chapter, he took him down to the potter's house and he said, I saw a work on the wheel, and the potter began to work the work, and he made it again another vessel. I don't want to be the same vessel I've always been. I might have used to be a dung pot, but I don't want to be a dung pot for the rest of my life. God, crush me if you have to, so I don't have to be a dung pot. I don't want to carry mess for the rest of my life. I want to be a vessel of honor and not unto dishonor. Lord, make me again another vessel. So that means I may have to be crushed sometimes. fight anymore.
Uh-huh.
Those of y'all that don't understand what dump pot means, my grandmama was old school. She didn't want to get up, go all the way to the bathroom in the middle of the night.
Come on now.
Back in the day, they had outhouses.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
You weren't going out to the outhouse.
No, you were not.
In the middle of the night.
No.
So they had a pot that they kept next to the bed.
Yeah.
Now y'all take the rest of the reference from there.
Yeah. Come on. That's all right.
Yes,
sir. Woo.
Bible says, in every house. I got to preach the book. In every house, there are many vessels. Some unto honor, and some unto dishonor. I don't want to be a dishonorable vessel. I don't want to be a dumb pot. I don't want to always carry mess in my life. Lord, make me over again. What I really want to carry is the oil. I want. Somebody just holler, I want the oil.
I want the oil.
I gotta hurry. So when we see oil, it represents the anointing of God in the scriptures. And we gotta get back to the place where the people of God say, God, I want the anointing on and in my life.
Yeah.
Notice what I said. I didn't just say on my life, I said in my life. I want to be like David said, my cup runs over. I want people to touch me and get the oil because it's running up out of me. Y'all not talking. I want them to touch me and get the oil because it's coming from out of the inner sanctum of my soul, because I've been with God, because he's filled me to overflowing. I want you to get from the overflow in my life. I want you to just get him to put something on me. Y'all not talking. I don't want him to just put something on me so it'll help you. I want to have power in my day-to-day life. Now, I'm ready to shift. And so when we see the oil, there are a few points in the scripture where we talk about oil. Now there's many more than this, but I'm just going to reference three and I'm going to get on out your way. In Jeremiah 8, as I closed last night, there was a question asked, is there a balm in Gilead? I feel like preaching. Is there a balm in Gilead? That word is not B-O-M-B, it's B-A-L-M. It's a salve. It's a medicinal, almost like a cream or a gel that they would put on the body for places where there were wounds, and they would be healing their flow from the balm. Oh, help me here, God. And so what I found out as I began to study was that the balm of Gilead was made from a resin or an oil that comes from a tree called the balsam tree. That grew in the region of Gilead. And the balsam tree was a very special tree because in order to get the resin out, it had to be cut. I can't get a church right there. In order to get the resin, in order to get the oil out, it had to be cut. We got to get past the day where we are a church that doesn't want to be cut. If you want the oil for real, you got to be willing to allow God to cut on you so he can get the oil out of you. That's what he's trying to do. He's been cutting on you for a reason. And oil that came from the balsam tree. See, what you don't understand, we preached it before, but now you got to really get it. The stuff, when God is cutting on you, I told you, the balm in Gilead is to bring healing to the nation. It's to bring healing to people. What you ain't figured out yet is what God is taking you through and developing in you is a process. What you are built for is the oil. And when he's cutting you, he's cutting you so somebody else can be healed.
Thank you, Mama.
See, when Torah say, God cut me.
Yeah.
I'm not in this world for myself. Cut me. Because one thing I figured out, Sister Rosalind, is when God starts cutting, he's not going to cut you to the point where he's going to destroy you. Unless you are unwilling to yield to his will. Oh, they holler right there. I said something right there. He's not going to cut you to destroy you unless you're not going to yield to his will. The text says in the New Testament, he said there was a tree that was planted, and the vine, the man who managed the orchard or the vineyard, he said, let it grow. He said, cultivate this tree for a little while longer, and if it does not produce, then cut it down. But I come to tell you today, God's goal is not to cut you down. His goal is to cut on you so he can get the oil out of you. Are you willing to allow God to cut on you? Yeah. The next step I looked at is now when we start dealing with a woman. I read Matthew chapter 26. There was a woman who had an alabaster box. And her alabaster box and what was in it represented a whole year of wages. And this woman, when she came before Jesus, she came and she recognized who he was. And something about when you have a recognition about the deity and the power of who's before you, it will transform your very life. You can't help but worship. You can't help but give him glory. You can't sit quietly in a sanctuary. When they start singing, I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice. They don't have to beg you and plead with you for you to start worshiping. When they start talking about how good he's been, because something on the inside registers with the man that is sitting before you by the name of Jesus Christ, and you get a bad case of the I can't help it. I can't help but praise him. I can't help but worship. I can't help but give him glory. I can't help but shout. I can't help but dance.
I can't help it.
He forgave me of a whole lot. I can't hear nobody. Y'all might try to act like y'all been wonderful all of your life, but there are a few of us in here that know that even since we've been saved, we have dropped the ball. We didn't get it all right. And so, yes, I owe God. I owe him a prayer. So she took the alabaster box, and one text says she anointed his head. One text says she anointed his feet. Now, which one is right? Both of them. One often noted one thing, one often noted another. It doesn't mean that they're invalid. The point is, she broke her box. Here's what messed me up about that. Listen. When she broke the box, when you get to a point where you break your box, what comes out of it is uncontrolled. I'll be riding down the street and have to pull my car over because tears will start streaming down my face because I've thought about how good he is. I've thought about whose presence I'm in. I can't help but give him glory. I break my box. I'm almost there. Real oil represented that oil in that alabaster box was called spikenard. And it had a strong fragrance.
Come on.
So much so that even a little bit would fill up a room. But this woman broke her whole box. Filled with spikenard. So imagine what that room smelled like that night. Imagine what that room smelled like when she broke the box. And if y'all don't think anything about oil, once you get oil on something, it's hard to get it out. When you're carrying real oil, when you got real Watch. So Jesus says, he says, y'all mad because she broke her box. She gave everything. And y'all got me every day and y'all don't give me everything. One text said, I came in this house and y'all didn't even wash my feet. I came in this house and you didn't even anoint me. But yet, here this woman is. She came in here and she anointed my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair because she loved me so much. Watch this, y'all. It was number one, it was costly. If you don't have real oil, it's going to be costly. Number two, if you got real oil, it's going to leave a fragrance behind. Number three, watch this. What they would do, Jesus said, he said, she's anointing my body for my burial. Symbolically. So, anointing, watch. Back in those days, they didn't have, superintendent, they didn't have an embalming process.
That's right. That's right.
So when you died, they would anoint your body with sweet smelling ointments so they wouldn't smell the smell of your decaying flesh. When you got real oil, you don't want anybody smelling your flesh. Lord have mercy. I want God to put real oil on me. So as my flesh is dying every single day, I want them to smell the fragrance of God on my life. So they would anoint the body with oil for the fragrance to cover, to keep away the decaying flesh. I'm going to hit this and I'm going to move. And I got to close. But in the church, we got too much flesh.
Amen.
I heard a revelation one time concerning Daniel in the lion's den. One of the reasons why the lions couldn't eat Daniel was because Daniel had been in the presence of God. The Bible said that Daniel prayed 3 times a day. The Bible said he would pray and seek the Lord. And they said, will you bow? No, I'm not bowing. And so because he didn't bow, but he prayed 3 times a day. Guess what? When we spend time in prayer, in relationship with God, guess what's going to happen? Your flesh is no longer the smell. The reason why the lions couldn't kill it, because it couldn't smell its flesh. Couldn't smell the flesh because spirit was alive. The Bible said the angels of the Lord came in that place and shut the mouth of the lion. Sorry, lion, you can't have this one. Can't smell his flesh. Why? Because he's been in God's face. What am I trying to preach to the body of Christ? I'm trying to preach to the body. Get back in God's face so you get the real oil on them. That way, the stuff you're out here tripping about, oh God, I feel this thing. You're out here tripping about your haters. You won't have to worry about your haters anymore. They won't have to preach about your haters because you won't even be worried about the lions. The lions can't smell your flesh.
Mama.
Okay, I gotta go. So, don't sit down, I'm making me nervous. But watch. So, it was for the sake of the flesh, the decaying flesh being covered. Now we know Jesus' flesh wasn't gonna be decaying.
Right.
But she was doing it symbolically.
Right.
I come to tell you today, you need your flesh covered.
Yes.
They don't need to smell your flesh, they need to smell him.
Yes.
They need to smell the oil.
Yes, yes.
And so, as I close, we go to Exodus 30. And in Exodus 30, it says, and this shall be a holy anointing oil.
Yes, sir.
And it gives us 5 ingredients for the holy anointing oil.
Yes. Amen.
Number one, it talks to us about the myrrh.
Yes. Uh-huh.
So what happens with myrrh? Myrrh is a very, very strong laxative. Myrrh is just like if you were to take Dulcolax, Exlax, and Metamucil all in one.
Wow.
Okay, let me go back to the old school. It's like taking Black Draw.
Yeah.
And and cast away.
There you go.
That will work that stuff out of you. That's how strong myrrh was as a purifier. If you're going to have the oil, you need some purification in your life. I can't get no help right there. If you're going to have the oil, you're going to have some purification. Ah, so then we got the myrrh, and the myrrh will come, and it's got to work through your system. If you're going to really have the oil, you got to say, God, purge me. Don't just get the nice stuff, but get the secret stuff.
Come on.
See, they don't holler about that, Sister Roz. They don't holler about that, Mr. Sandra. They don't holler on that. Get the secret stuff. Go to the inner places. Search my heart. And try my ways. Try my heart. And if there be any wicked way within me, clean me. That's the way you gotta pray if you want the oil. So there was myrrh. Then the next one said there was cinnamon. Cinnamon was an oil that represented obedience. Y'all know the scripture that says obedience is better than a sacrifice. When we start talking about incense, incense was generally made with some form of cinnamon in it because it produced a sweet smell and savor. Incense was always symbolic in the text of prayers going to God. If you're going to have the oil, you've got to have obedience in prayer. You've got to have obedience to what God speaks. You've got to have obedience in your life. If you're going to have real oil, somebody holler, I need to be obedient.
I need to be obedient.
I'm sorry if I'm taking too long with some of y'all, but I need to preach this tonight. I need obedience in my life. I need to obey God. Too many times we don't obey Him. We get, and God will say, do something, and we'll partway do it.
All right.
Too many times God will tell us, get up now and go pray. We'll say, I'll go pray, but I'll pray later on. No, but the anointing was there, and you were the window of heaven was open right then for you to go pray and for God to speak to you. But because you did not obey the thing that God was trying to release to your life, you missed it because you only partway obeyed.
Amen. Yes, sir.
If you don't have the oil, gotta have obedience. Then they had another one called the calamus or the cane. And the calamus grew up to about 10 feet tall in marshy places. But in order to get the fragrance out, it had to be crushed. Uh-oh. Y'all not talking?
Uh-oh. Yes, sir. Amen.
It had to be crushed. Let me take you back to your going through. What you're missing is the fact that in order to get the sweet smell, the sweet oil of the calamus, it had to be crushed. If God's going to get the sweet fragrance of calamus out of you, you've got to go through the crushing process.
Amen.
Watch this. And when I studied it, it said the more it's broken, the more it's crushed, the more fragrance comes out. Sometimes you got to get to a place where you start celebrating when God is allowing you to go through a crushing. Oh, God, when that